to Connie Martinson Talks Books. Humphrey Bogart, who can ever forget Casablanca, the Maltese Falcon, the man who was in The African Queen and won an Academy Award for it. But there was so much more to Humphrey Bogart. My guest today, Stephen Canfer, has written Tough Without a Gun, The Life and Extraordinary Afterlife of Humphrey Bogart. It's published by Alfred Knopf. Welcome, Stephen.
I'm glad to be here.
I am delighted to have you here because this is a book that one doesn't realize everything that was going on with the life of Humphrey Bogart.
Mm-hmm.
And even, as you say, the afterlife. AFI has voted him what?
Number one male movie star of all time, and I think deservedly so.
I know, but what a title.
Well, he deserved it. I mean, he's been gone for over 50 years. He died in 1957, and yet he's with us all the time. You see the movies on TCM, you see movies on festivals, people rent the movies. So obviously he supplies America with something it still needs, despite the fact that thousands of movies have been made since he left us.
Interesting, he's brought up in New York. Mother was a famous illustrator, mm-hmm. Maud.
Mm-hmm.
Father Belmont was a graduate of Phillips Andover Academy,
mm-hmm.
Yale, and Columbia Medical School.
All that. So obviously he had the prime background for a WASP of that period, and you would think, with the name Humphrey Bogart, that he would go nowhere. I mean, after all, the cinema is full of Rocks and Kirks and Tonys and people like that, his real name is Schwartz and Danielovich. But somehow, because of a combination of circumstance and his own indomitable will, that name Humphrey Bogart stuck with him. He didn't take a stage name. He didn't take a cinema name. And it somehow buried itself in our consciousness the way a more common name might not have.
And a kid who fell out of Andover ends up in the Navy and yet has a great friend named Brady. And what a difference the Brady family made in his life.
That's the Brady Bunch, or the real Brady Bunch.
Yeah.
Brady, despite that Irish name, was a Jewish guy. And was something of a successful producer of his time. And his son liked Humphrey. They got along pretty well. So he thought, well, in those days they had big casts, so you could give a kid a part and it wouldn't really matter if he wasn't very good. And Humphrey wasn't very good. His first role, he played a Japanese butler, for example.
You talk about him as a sprig, and I had never heard that expression before about a young actor.
That's what the critics call him, a sprig. And when you think of Bogart, you don't think of him as a juvenile lead and a pretty boy, but that's exactly what he was.
At that point, he meets Helen Menken.
Yes, his first wife.
She was more of a star than he ever dreamt of being at that point.
And their marriage was not a success, but it probably started him off in a good way because he was married to a famous actress, so people began to pay attention to him on stage. It didn't last. She was older than he, and I don't think he was really ready, frankly, to settle down.
Then there was Mary Philips.
Mary Philips was a very pretty girl, younger than he. He was really crazy about her, but she was an ingenue and a successful ingenue, and she wanted to stay in New York, and he wanted to go west and try his fortune in celluloid, yep. And so that didn't work.
So he comes out to here, to Los Angeles, is a 20th, paying, what, $650 a week that he never thought he would see on Broadway. And nothing happens, really. He does a few bits, and he trains some other actor to speak like he does. And he's just an also-ran at that point.
He's very much a second banana, and was even second time around when he was trying very, very hard to really make it in Hollywood. He was in gangster movies, but as he said, I spent more time writhing around on the floor than I did standing up because he was always shot by Edward G. Robinson or Jimmy Cagney or especially George Raft, who was his superior in every way at that point.
And then he goes back to New York and he is in one good play.
Yes. He's in The Petrified Forest, and it's rather interesting because it's cast against the part. Now we don't think of it that way, but he was this pretty boy who suddenly became Duke Mantee. He was cast in the part because the director said there's a silence around him. People watch him when he's on stage, even though it's an unshaven, tough guy on the lam, a kind of John Dillinger of that period. Leslie Howard was the real star and the co-producer of the play and loved Humphrey in the part and wanted to bring him out to Hollywood. And that was kind of Humphrey's break because A, Leslie Howard wanted him, and B, because even though Warners really wanted Edward G. Robinson, Edward G. Robinson was making too much money and Jack Warner didn't like to be pushed around by actors or by writers whom he called schmucks with Underwoods. So he said, no, we'll take this new guy. What's his name? Bogart? Okay, we'll try him. And it worked out just fine.
And it comes out, and he's also married Mayo Methot.
Yes.
And they are really the battling Bogarts.
She's wife number three. She was really, it's all very merry, the way he described her he described her as Sluggy, and even named his boat Sluggy. But the fact is she was an alcoholic and very disturbed and violent woman, verbally abusive and finally physically abusive, stabbed him in the back with a knife. This was hushed up at the time. I go into it in some detail in the book. But it was a marriage that was never going to work, but he worked at it very hard. And when this 19-year-old came into view, he still wanted his third marriage to work out.
Listen, along the way, there's a woman who was his hairdresser, mm-hmm. stylist, mm-hmm. who claims in her book that he was still seeing her while he was married to Lauren Bacall.
I think it's probably so. I mean, I certainly treat it seriously, but I think that marriage, nonetheless, was a good marriage. Humphrey had a lot of trouble settling in to any relationship. He was really in love with Lauren Bacall, but he was also very much in love with his career.
Yeah.
And I think in many ways that came first.
And meanwhile, he comes out here, he owes a great deal, and he never forgot it, to Leslie Howard.
That's right, to the point where his daughter, who he only knew to the age of five, was named for Leslie. Her name is Leslie Bogart. He always paid his debts, and interestingly enough, earlier on, to show you what kind of man he was, his father, though they were wealthy at first, lost his fortune. He had no money at all. In fact, he died in debt. And Humphrey, who was not famous at that point, paid back every dime.
Yeah, that was really extraordinary.
Mm-hmm.
With Hollywood, he really was one of Jack Warner's stars. Mm-hmm. But Jack Warner controlled anybody who walked in that studio.